After experiencing the horrors of World War I firsthand, a brave lieutenant general defied the U.S. Army and set out to create his own aviation project, the Experimental Night Bomber Long Range. The Witteman-Lewis XNBL-1, commonly known as the Barling Bomber, was the largest aircraft ever built back then and ended up winning several impressive world records. The product of idealistic passions, this behemoth of an aircraft exceeded the technological realities of the 1920s and was the face of a political storm that surrounded the future of America's military might after the war. It was also one of America's strangest long-range bomber experiments ever built. Learning from the war. After returning home from World War I, U.S. Army Air Service Lieutenant General Billy Mitchell was convinced that the future of global warfare over land and sea lay in the development and technological advancements of air power, particularly in strategic bombing. While the Navy relentlessly pressed for more battleships at the taxpayers' expense, Mitchell argued that bomber aircraft would be much more efficient at securing coastlines. Besides, they were also close to 1,000 times less expensive than what was being built at the time. Navy top officials were outraged at Mitchell's claims, and he was eventually court-martialed because of his public statements and criticism. Wanting to prove that he was right, Mitchell then decided to turn his idea into a reality and create a strategic long-range bomber capable of carrying a bomb load so large that it could sink a battleship. Luckily, he knew just who to contact. Years earlier, in 1919, Mitchell met Walter H. Barling, a British aircraft designer who had previously been employed by the Royal Aircraft Factory. Barling was the principal designer of the Tarrant Tabor, a British bomber with a similar concept that was unfortunately destroyed in a fatal nosedive crash during its maiden voyage. Undeterred, Mitchell asked Barling to help him design another bomber to demonstrate the effectiveness of air power in land and sea battles. Agreeing that a large bomber was a feasible opportunity, Barling emigrated to the United States in 1920 and began sketching ideas in the Army Engineering Division. XML-1. In 1920, Lieutenant Mitchell approved specifications for two prototype variations of a similar triplane. Initially named the Experimental Night Bomber Long Range, or XNBL-1, the aircraft would be capable of carrying a 5,000-pound bomb load, flying up to 10,000 feet, and reaching a cruising speed of at least 100 miles per hour. Like Barling's Tabor, the XNBL-1 aircraft was a large six-engine triplane with a cigar-shaped fuselage. Like many aircraft at the time, the XNBL-1 became a product of political warfare, and the design was subject to America's contemporary bureaucratic reality. Due to a large surplus of 420-horsepower V-12 Liberty engines at the end of World War I, Congress mandated that the aircraft use such motors for every new product. Barling then decided to mount four of them between the lower and middle wings in a tractor arrangement, and two additional ones in a pusher position. The massive XNBL-1 had a gross weight of 42,569 pounds, and the engineers even fixed a set of wheels in its nose's front underside to prevent it from rolling over onto itself. The aircraft, nicknamed the Barling Bomber, had a crew of six. Two pilots seated in an open cockpit located on the nose, a flight engineer behind them, a navigator and radio operator in separate compartments, and a bombardier positioned in the lower nose on a small bicycle seat. The bombardier sitting below the pilots had to send requests to the cockpit for course or speed correction via a pulley and rope assembly. Also, most of the crew had access to the aircraft's seven self-defense 7.62mm machine guns, giving them a field of fire that covered the entire area around the bomber. Unlike earlier bombers, the XNBL-1 carried its bomb load internally, mounted on an enclosed bomb bay beneath the gasoline tanks. The aircraft also stood out because of another first, having bomb bay doors. This feature was incorporated to the bottom of the fuselage and could accommodate any bomb in the air service inventory, including the 4,000-pound one designed to sink a battleship. Production. After a short bidding war between several companies, the New Jersey-based Witteman-Lewis Company was selected to manufacture the aircraft's components. Said parts were delivered by train from New Jersey to Barling's working space at the U.S. Army Engineering Division at McCook Field in Ohio, where the aircraft were actually constructed. The long-distance assembly caused severe problems, as the parts did not often fit together as planned. Soon after receiving the contract for two $375,000 prototypes, the design changes kept escalating and raised the price to $525,000. The order was thus reduced to one, and Witteman-Lewis had no choice but to absorb the cost overrun. Additionally, when the engineers discovered that the fabric wings often trapped rainwater and distorted the initial weight and balance measurements, a sizable custom-made hangar with a hefty price tag of $700,000 was built to keep construction going despite the weather. The bomber was finally shipped by rail to Ohio in May of 1923, and after 94 days of assembly, it became the largest aircraft in the world. Too mighty for its own good. On August 22, 1923, the bomber performed its maiden flight with a four-person crew, including test pilots Lieutenants Harold Harris and Muir Fairchild, civilian flight engineer Douglas Culver, and an excited Barling himself. After taxiing onto the right field grass runway, the monstrous aircraft took off after a run of 960 feet in just 13 seconds. Despite Barling's excitement, who described the experience of flying aboard his own planes as, quote, a romantic manuscript of human accomplishment, the flight only lasted a short time in the air, and the feat quickly uncovered the aircraft's many shortcomings. Lieutenants Harris and Fairchild then took the bomber to plenty of air shows through 1923 and 1924. The giant Barling bomber attracted plenty of attention everywhere it went, and it set duration and altitude world records for lifting payloads of 4,400 pounds to 6,800 feet and 6,600 pounds to 5,344 feet. Despite the impressive showings and the aircraft's ability to carry such bomb loads, the Witteman-Lewis XNBL-1 was seriously underpowered, and its performance was disappointing to all involved. The overly complex structure of its three wings, along with all its accompanying struts and bracing wires, created such immense drag that the surplus engines could not compensate. Fully loaded, the XNBL-1 could only reach a top speed of 96 miles per hour and 170-mile range, far less than expected for a functioning strategic bomber. In addition, the engines were unable to get the aircraft to its initially planned ceiling of 7,725 feet. These issues were further highlighted when the aircraft failed to make an appearance at Bowling Field in Washington, D.C., as the plane was unable to achieve enough height to go over the Appalachian Mountains and turned around. Cancellation. Further trials unveiled plenty more inadequacies, forcing the project to be halted for several years. In addition, when Kansas Congressman Daniel R. Anthony learned of the Barling's staggering costs, plus the $700,000 hangar, he objected to the project's continuity. The U.S. Congress then decided to cancel further work on the aircraft, including building a second prototype. After so many deficiencies and underwhelming performances, the aircraft earned the nickname Mitchell's Folly. The moniker came from the Lieutenant General's incessant pushing and funding. The XNBL-1's last flight took place in 1925, the same year that Mitchell was court-martialed for his harsh criticism for the military. Not entirely a failure. After the end of the Witteman-Lewis XNBL-1 project, the massive bomber was dismantled and placed in a warehouse. The aircraft's manufacturer had gone out of business by this time, as the expenses were too significant to keep the corporation afloat. Years later, when Major Henry Hap Arnold discovered the plane's remnants, he ordered that they be burned in an effort to hide the evidence of the failed project from the American taxpayers. To this day, all that remains from the Endeavor are two wheels from its inventive and revolutionary landing gear system. The XNBL-1 was simply too massive and overly ambitious for its time, serving as a lingering embarrassment for those involved in the project, who believed in its unique potential until the last minute. Still, an aircraft like the Barling cannot be classified as a complete failure. In fact, Lieutenant Mitchell was right in his predictions, and strategic air bombers became the backbone of America's wins in modern warfare. The lessons learned during the long effort to build the XNBL-1 forced the design team to overcome several engineering hurdles, and available records from wind tunnel tests and theoretical analyses of assembly details were applied to the next generations of large bombers, such as the B-15, B-17, B-19, and ultimately the iconic Boeing B-29 Superfortress. Despite its legacy as a failed strategic heavy bomber, the Barling bomber was a technological pioneer for its time, and remained the largest American aircraft for a decade, until the arrival of the Boeing XB-15 in 1935. Thank you for watching our Dark Skies video. Let us know your thoughts on the Barling Bomber aircraft in the comments below, and hit the bell icon to get notifications of our latest content. Also, don't forget to subscribe to this and all the other Dark Documentaries channels for more history-inspired stories.